Just hooked into a fish, fishing no more than 30 or 40 yards out, and that is what I love about the Daiwa longbows. They've got such a lovely, soft playing action. I can feel every single lunge this fish is giving me, but equally, it's just coming through a weed bed now, but because the rod is so forgiving, it's still absorbing every single lunge, and I can still feel everything that's going on. I think sometimes we get a little bit too carried away with the stiffest rod that we possibly can and forget about the actual enjoyment of playing a fish. Thankfully, it looks like we're winning this battle. You can just see him coming over the weed now. Just look at the action of the rod. It's almost bent through to the butt section. Absolute joy to play these fish in. Get in. There we have it, another carp falling foul to the longbow rods. A very distinguishable upper double common. Well chuffed with this one. This is the naked chod system, and I'm going to show you why, in my opinion, it's the only chod system that you'll ever need to use again. Now, it's very, very easy to set up, and when you pick it up from your tackle shop, you'll see that it all comes in a neat sprue, it's all together, and you can't buy the wrong components. It's all there ready for you. The first thing that you will actually do is to thread this reverse tapered bead that you can see by my thumb straight onto your main line. Follow that, you'll put your chod rig. Now, you can use one of the ready-tied chod rigs that we offer, or as you can see, I've tied my own using the crimp tool. Now, I just want to point out while I'm talking about the rig there, I have crimped a loop into it. And when you look at the packaging on the crimp tool, it says, you know, we don't recommend it. I just want to tell you why I do. It gives the rig a lot more movement to start with. It makes it a lot more aggressive in the water and makes it turn a lot quicker. Now, we've got a knot testing machine at work. Obviously, we get to test everything before we release anything to make sure there's nothing wrong with it before it comes onto the market. And when you use a crimp on it, the 20-pound mouth trap will break at 18 or 19 pound. Now, there's no way that you're ever going to get that sort of pressure from the other end when you're playing a fish in, which is why I'm happy to do it. We have to put what we put on the packaging because it is lower than the stated breaking strain of the material. Carrying on with the system, the next item that goes on is this barrel bead that you can see here. It too has tungsten impregnated into it, and everything is there to make sure that it all sinks gently on the bottom, but to make sure that it stays pinned down. It's finished off with one of our silicone sleeves tied to the smallest lead that you can get away with. 1.5 ounces is my favoured. That's just, in my opinion, the best way to fish a chod rig. Now, the thing with the chod rig is that it can quite literally be cast anywhere and you'll be safe in the knowledge that it's still presented. The reason for this is that you fish it with a critically balanced, but you fish it with a pop-up and you critically balance it. As you can see, if you imagine your lead coming in through the water, the rig is going to actually shoot up to the surface or to the highest bead, and then as you start to slacken off your line, it's slowly sinking down. The rig will find its natural position in between the two beads, but whatever it lays across, be it weed, be it silt, any other debris that might be laying on the bottom, this is still sitting gently above it. So wherever you cast it, it will be presented. Don't get me wrong, I don't recommend using this particular rig over any bottom, but if I'm fishing over gravel or over clay, I'd be much happier fishing a bottom bait anyway. But if you're unsure what you're fishing over, or if you see a fish roll and you're not quite sure what's out there, this, in my opinion, is the best rig to get out there. Now, it does have to be fished with a very buoyant pop-up. You do need this to be standing true for the however long you've got it out in the water for. In the past, it's meant me rolling a lot of my own cork balls or getting someone at work to roll some cork balls for me. But in more recent times, the latest range of mainline pop-ups are far more buoyant than they've ever been, and they maintain their buoyancy for well over 48 hours. So much so that you can, you know, buy them off the shelf quite happily, but you add a little bit of glug to them as well, and they're still perfect for whatever length of time you need them out there. So that's the naked chod system. I've been using it to great effect and with some really good success for the past 18 months or so. I had a common recently in the winter at just over £35 called the Undulated, and more recently had a 50-year-old carp called Pinky at just over £28. I'm sure if you give the bits a go yourself, you'll get some similar results too. There we go. I've been fishing one rod on boilies using the chod rig that we spoke about earlier, utilising the crimp tool. It rattled off a little while ago, and I've been lucky enough to catch this 32-pound stunning mirror carp. So happy you wouldn't believe.
One of the many new important products we've brought out this year is the drill and cork system. Seemingly quite simple, but it's something that all of us use for many, many years now and is an essential item in our tackle boxes. Using this in two sizes, 6mm and 8mm, allows us to create a wide variety of balanced bait options. One of the key rigs that we use to create with the drill and cork plug system is the muzzer, the infamous muzzer, which Tom and a few of the guys have been using with great success for many years now. Basically, that is a boilie that's been drilled out and plugged with cork. I'm using it here on my stiff bottom bait rig, but generally that's been used in association with the KD rig, with a whipping coming off by the eye and then foamed up. That's how Tom uses it to great effect. I like to use it here just with a cork plug, which takes away the weight of the hook, negates that weight entirely and makes the bait behave very naturally on the bottom. And it's been proven for many, many years now that a neutral buoyancy hook bait or something that it behaves a little bit different from the offerings can be very, very successful at outwitting your carp. So that's one way. That's the 8mm drill and cork plug I've used for that, for the nice big boilie. If you're using something like a 14mm boilie, then the 6mm drill and cork would be a better option for that. Another great tactic is balanced tiger nuts. Tiger nuts and cork go hand in hand as something that I personally use for 20 years or more now. Very, very effective tactic. And what I've done here is I've drilled out a pair of nuts and then mounted them side by side onto a piece of cork. And then that is simply slid onto the rig, similar sort of rig, or you could fish it on a strip back end trap style rig. Not too important, but sharp hook. Tidy rig obviously is very important. Balanced tiger nuts over a sprinkling of tiger nuts or over a sprinkling of hemp, very, very effective indeed. So they are just two key uses for the new drill and cork plug system. Absolutely essential item in my tackle box. Proper old warrior this, lovely old common, 22.5 pound. They're starting to come on the baited area now, which I'm putting in 18mm of the new hybrid bait from Mainline. I'm just putting that out with the catapult to a little hole in the weed and they're starting to show over it. This is a second bite off the spot. Beautiful old fish, and I caught him on my favourite bottom bait presentation, which is a short little stiff rig, and I'll show you how I make that next. This is my favourite bottom bait presentation. It's a rig I've been using with a lot of success over the past year. It evolved from accidentally catching a fish on a chod rig with a bottom bait. Tom Dove and I were out one day, cast to a fish, caught it, and then when we put the rig in the edge afterwards, Tom said, "Your rig's fallen over." Checked it, and I put a bottom bait on by mistake in my haste. But obviously noted it, the fish was well nailed, and I caught one, and I filed that away in the back of my mind. I was on a session up to a lake in Brentwood earlier this year, and the fish were on me, but I wasn't getting the bites. So I remembered that sort of chod rig with a bottom bait presentation, put it out, and over the course of the following day, managed to catch about 15 fish in just a few hours, including a lake record. So gone on to use it a few other places. I've refined it, and this is the version that it's in at the moment. It's the version that I'm using on this particular session as well. So I'll take you through the key components. First of all, I have a size 6 mixer hook. Now, if I'm fishing in open water, you know, if there's no snags or anything like that, then a size 6 mixer is absolutely perfect for this. If I'm fishing in weed, then I'll up it to a wide gape or even a wide gape X and couple it with 25-pound IQ2. The standard version is this one, though, size 6 mixer to IQ2 in 20 pounds. So I start off with a whipping knot, same whipping knot that we use on the chod rig, and that's just whipped down, and as you can see, I've cut the tag end off. So there is no hair that's a standard continuation of the knot. There's no D, nothing like that. It's just trimmed off. The hair itself is formed from a soft, supple, supernatural section, which is just slightly longer than the bait. So I've got an 18 millimeter bait here, and that hair section is about 25 mil probably, something like that. It's tied to a mini rig ring, and that slides on the shank of that size 6 mixer hook in that manner. And I've got a small stop bead just on the bend of the hook. It's about in the right position there, which stops the bait coming all the way around onto the point. So it's got a lot of movement. The bait is nice and supple, sits flat on the bottom. Always find that with a stiff hook link, and this is a stiff hook link because it's 20 pound IQ2, if you do continue that through with the hair, then the rig can sit strangely, the hook can sit off the bottom, upside down. But with a supple hair and a stiff hook link, everything tends to sit nice and flat. Now, the actual boom section, I wouldn't fish it any longer than this. This is about 4 inches. I quite often fish it about 3 inches. And that's stiff enough that even with this 18 millimeter hybrid bait, that will still boom it down away from the lead and it'll all sit flat. The loop is to give the rig plenty of movement and ensure that no matter which direction the carp can come from, it can easily ingest this stiff hook link. So it will give it flexibility in every direction. And once that's in the mouth, I'm sure that they find it very, very difficult to get away with. In fact, the hook holds that I've been getting with this are as good as what I get with the chod rig. Nailed in the middle of the bottom lip every time. Very, very rare to get any losses. And yeah, just very, very tangle proof as well, which is a key aspect. Cast this pretty much anywhere knowing that it won't tangle. I like to fish this on a leg call leader, set up helicopter style. On this session, I have got one rod fishing it on a leg clip because that's in a weedy area and helicopter rigs in thick weed aren't really that conducive. So one's on a leg clip, but generally over a cleanish bottom or light weed, I will fish it on a helicopter. So I've got the 2 ounce lead there. We'll drop it down as light as a one if I'm fishing very, very close. Quick link, sleeved with a heli rubber. As I should just mention, I've cut the swivel off the lead there, as you can see. Quick link goes onto the loop. Heli rubber goes over the top. We've got a barrel bead, which holds everything down nice and tight. Barrel bead, not really necessary. That's for when you're using a chod rig for holding the hook away from the lead, so that can stay out of the way like that. A bit of travel. I've caught well on this rig with the bottom bait rig flying back as much as 2.5 feet. Which is a bit of a surprise, a bit different. But generally that sort of travel, a few inches is ample. And at the top, we've got, of course, the no trace system with the bead that comes off, the safest helicopter system in the world, and a total first from Corda. I've got that on a leg core leader. I'm fishing this on a gravel bottom. So this is one of our cable leaders. And it's about 3/4 of a meter long or so with a spliced loop in the end. And I would just use a 5-turn grinner knot to connect that to the main line, which would be 20 pound subline. That is my favorite bottom bait presentation at the moment. It's a rig I've been using a lot everywhere and catching a lot of fish on. Give it a go.
I'm now going to take you through Corda's range of quick change accessories and metalware, which help make it a lot easier. The first one that I'm going to show you is the Quick Link. As you can see from the clip, it's very neat, very small, very tidy. It's available in two sizes. This is the largest version. It's also available in extra small. Really, it comes down to personal preference as to which you prefer to use. They all can be used with each of the bits I'm going to show you. As you can see, it's got a small recess, making it very, very easy to clip on your chosen rig. On this particular instance, I'm also using a link loop. And as you can see, it just slides round onto the link and sits into place. Once that's done, simply take one of our 3mm silicone sleeves, slide it over the top of everything, and it just ensures that there's no chance of the clip coming undone, and it helps in anti-tangle properties as well. Just move that up a bit further. And that is ready to cast, ready to go. That's the first one. The second one, some people don't like to tie on the link loop. They prefer to use the figure of eight. So, as you can see here, there's a rig ready to go with a figure of eight loop knot on. And this time, I'm going to put it onto a stick clip. Now this is different in that it's slightly longer, very, very good for when you're using this type of loop. Very easy for when you're pulling through stick mixes, it's all a lot smaller than pulling a link loop through. The clip itself, you simply squeeze together, and as you can see, it opens up either side, and you simply move the loop around, and it sits into place as before. Equally though, I'd always recommend the use of one of our 3mm silicone sleeves. You can cut them down if you require, but with this particular clip, I like to keep it at its full length, and it ensures again that everything remains neat and tidy. The final one that I'm going to show you is actually probably the least used in the whole of the Korda range, and in my opinion, it's one of the best. It's the ring clip. As you can see, it's got a similar system at the top that the stick clip previously had, where you just simply squeeze it together to put on your chosen metalware or loop. But the clever bit is at the other end. It's shaped so that it still maintains a full-size ring to allow for extra movement. So if you like, if helicopter rigs are your favoured method of fishing, this one is for you. I've chosen again to use a link loop with this one. It's always my preferred choice. So by squeezing it together, the link loop goes round as before, and once again, your silicone sleeve just pops over the top. As you can see from the full rig, it still maintains full movement all the way round very, very easily as well. This could be used if you prefer to use a length of tubing here, or a leg core leader, safe zone leader, anything like that. It's big enough to free run along all of them. As I've said, they're all personal choices. I'm sure there's one in the range that will definitely suit you. Might just be worth giving it a go.
Right, a lovely little 20 from Winters Lake on the Manor Farm complex. This one was taken on the little third rod down the bay here, probably a neglected area. You know, it's well worth taking into account these little spots. The open water rods that I've had, I haven't produced any big fish, and the biggest one of the session so far has come to the third rod down here. It was quite deep by the reeds, nice little spot, clonked down, handful of boilies over the top on a naked chod rig, and this is the result. Lovely. I'm going to slip him back and see if we can get a couple more.
Right, this is my favourite rig. It hasn't actually got a name, I just call it my N-Track pop-up rig. And I like to use it when I'm using small pop-ups. I find it works better if the split shot isn't too big, you know. So I'm going to run through the components that I use and when and why I'd use it. I like to use pop-ups in clear water, not so much in murky water, because I think a pop-up's greatest benefit is its visual aspect. So if the water's a bit murky, I tend to fish in the bottom. So this works better in clear water and on clean bottom. So some people think pop-ups are for fishing in weed, but you can definitely, or certainly, fish them on all types of clean bottom. So this is my clean bottom, clear water, general purpose pop-up rig. So going through the components, first of all, we've got the size 8 choddy hook here. Barbed, and if you notice that the section of most people here, this bit here is normally peeled. I like to keep the coating going straight through because I think it helps for the hook turning. So it's like having shrink tube but without having it. Just above the split shot, if you notice, there's a slight break in the coating. Now that allows the pop-up to sit up straight off the bottom. If you didn't do that, it would sit on a bit of a wonk. So you need to break that coating so it sits up straight. Coming down the end trap, the coated end trap, you notice the sinker here. That helps to kick it away as it goes onto the bottom. You know, you cast out, you feel the lead down like so, and first of all, the hook then pushes away to the sinker, and then the pop-up will push away from there. Moving up the rig to the swivel, we've got a flexi ring swivel, which is attached to the hybrid leg clip there. You know, I like the hybrid leg clip. The best thing about it is the swivel's moulded inside, and that stops the swivel from popping out the front. Tower rubber is just nicked onto there. Got a 2 ounce distance swivel lead there, and dark matter tubing. The tubing must be at least 2 inches longer than your hook link, because that stops the hook link looping around the back, and you don't want that because obviously that's going to get your tangles. So just taking you through how I tie it. First of all, I'll just get hold of that pop up. The hair has to be stripped first. So you strip the hair, place the pop up on the hair. That helps you get the right hair length. I thread the hook on. I bring the hook up to the pop-up so it's just touching. I then wind round the 9-turn knotless knot. That brings the coils round just past level with the point, because once I thread it back through the back of the eye for the second time and pull it tight, that bottom coil slips up and it will leave the hair exiting plush with the point, and that is where I want it. Once you've got the hook tied on and the bait on the hair, the next step is to thread the hook link through the stripper tool and bring it up to roughly an inch from the eye of the hook to the actual blade of the cutter. Then you drop the hook link down into the cutter, and very carefully you have to break through the coating with the blade, but only remove or peel back as such, probably only an inch, not even an inch, we're talking half inch of the material. The split shot goes on there and thus nestles up against the ruffled up coating of the end trap. Then I thread the sinker on, that comes down from that end, and then it's tied to the swivel of the hybrid leg clip. So what have I caught on this rig? This year alone, I've had a fish called the Client, 46 pounds, had a few others from the venue, fishing really long range. You know, people would be worried about using a light pop-up like this, casting long range, that it might tangle, but having this coated section, you know, coming out of the eye, which most people have peeled, definitely prevents tangles, and I definitely think that it helps with the hooking potential of the rig. Also this year, I caught a fish called Starries from Kingsmead near Heathrow. That's 46 pounds, and I caught it on the first visit to the venue. Had seven others in that session, another 30 and a few small ones. Obviously, I've caught a lot of other fish on this rig at other times, but they're just a couple of examples for you. So if you're gonna tie this rig for yourself, pay special attention to the little 5mm break by the split shot. Loosen the fibers up at the bottom here, because that allows the pop-up to sit up straight. And then remember to just curve this little hook section, and that will help for it to turn in the palm of your hand, just like so. So hopefully you'll tie it up good and you'll take it out and catch a few.
One of the most exhilarating, heart-thumping types of fishing has got to be floater angling, and it's one of my favourites. I've done a lot of it this year, and one of those was on a Hunt's Corner session, which was truly memorable. Both me, Richard Stewart and Ali Hamidi caught loads of fish on that session, and I can't wait to go back next year. Anyway, let me show you what I use for my floater fishing, because there are some essential bits of kit. I'll start with the rod and the reel. Having the correct tools for the job is absolutely essential. This is a DF Longbow Special, and it's a floater rod designed exactly for that job. It's 2.25 pound test curve, and that's there for a reason. If you're using rods that are too heavy, you're gonna bump fish off. You're using very, very light hooks, say size 8s, 10s and 12s, and you couple that with very light hook links. And using a rod that's too stiff, you're gonna bump them off at close quarters, so that is absolutely crucial. You're gonna need to couple the rod with a nice compact little reel. And this is a Daiwa Ballistic. The line lay is absolutely beautiful, and the clutch, it's like clockwork. You hook a fish on this and the clutch is gonna do everything for you. So two very, very good bits of kit, and they are essential in floater fishing. Now let me take you onto the end tackle itself. You'll see here, I'm using an interceptor. This is my favorite float because a lot of my floater fishing is at range. And these babies will cast anything up to 50, 60 yards. And if you're a big caster, sometimes they'll go even further than that. They fly like darts. These really are good bits of kit. Great thing about them is they're interchangeable too. And they come in three or four different sizes. So if you look here, you can literally just pull them off of the stem, straight off of the line, and that's released. And then you can put sort of a heavier or a lighter one on, depends on what you're doing in your fishing. So let's just pop that back on. Simple. This is designed inline, so all you need to do is thread your line through the middle of the interceptor, tie it to a size 11 ring swivel, and this goes down to your actual hook length itself, which is cruiser control in 10 pound. This stuff's neutral buoyancy, so it will lay on the surface perfectly, and that comes down to a size wide gape hook, and I'll use either a size 8 wide gape or a mixer, it depends on the circumstances. If it's very, very weedy and the conditions are demanding and I need a little bit of power in the hook, then I'll use a wide gape. On the other hand, if it's nice and clear and I'm going for ultra sharpness, I'll go for a size 8 mixer. So chop and change really, it varies from lake to lake, and it's up to you to choose which pattern you want, but both are very, very good. Then we run down to the hook bait itself. You'll notice that I'm using pink here, And that's there for a reason. A lot of my fishing is at distance, a lot of the floater fishing that I do, and I need to see that hook bait because I'm actually setting that hook as soon as a carp takes in the hook bait. And if it wasn't pink and it was just a normal floater colour, it'd be very, very difficult to see. And all I'd be watching is for the float twitching. That said, sometimes carp can be very, very cute. So matching your hook bait to the offerings can often be a winner. So I do have them at my disposal as well. And I'll often super glue these to the back of the shank and just watch the float. As soon as that float twitches, wallop, you strike. So that's a very, very important part of floater fishing. I'm going to give you a little tip now as well. When I'm floater fishing, you need this hook link to be as buoyant as physically possible. And so what I often do is either smear Vaseline up the hook link like so, or another little tip for you if you haven't got any Vaseline is to use a natural oils off of your body. So it sounds a bit weird, but give the sides of your nose a little rub behind your ears where all the sweat gathers and smear it up the hook link 2 inches away from the hook bait, right up the hook link like so. And that'll just make it a lot more buoyant and sit in the upper layers exactly how you want it to. So it's a nice little tip, that one. And like I said, I've only been talking about long range fishing here because that's what I do. But for those of you that don't and actually catch carp a lot closer than I do, I would go for a different style float. I'd use one of these little cruiser controllers here, these little skittle-like controllers. They cast beautifully and they make minimum splash, that's minimum disturbance at close range. They'll literally plop in and you can keep nice and quiet and not spook those fish. So now hopefully I've persuaded you to do a little bit of floater fishing. It really is exhilarating type of angling, so get out there and give it a go.
Right, for all you beginners out there, I can see that it can be a bit of a minefield with all the range of products that are available to you and not knowing where to start. So what I'm going to show you today is some products that are very easy to use and that will catch any carp that swims from any venue. So you can use these products in complete confidence, knowing that they're working perfectly well for you. So I'll start with, first of all, what they call a leg clip action pack. And what that consists of is an anti-tangle setup and a leg clip system. So you thread your main line through the tubing, through the tail rubber, through the leg clip, where the lead is attached like so. You would then attach to the other end, so your main line would be here. You would then tie on your ready rig here. You would then pull this inside, draw it inside the clip, and that just clicks in place like so. So there you have it. That's the leg clip action pack. And this is like a proper anti-tangle system. So you cast out, won't tangle, very strong, very reliable, and very safe. Most importantly, very safe. So all you do from there is you take your bait. I've got a 18mm boilie with a piece of plastic corn. I would draw that onto the hair using a gate closed needle. Open up the little loop at the top and add a little boilie stop like so. That just stops your bait from falling off. So you put that in there and there you have it. Right, like I said, you could take this setup absolutely anywhere and catch any carp that swims. You could add a PVA bag to this, either a long chuck, a boilie, or a funnel web system. You could use pellets, stick mix, anything you want. The possibilities are totally endless. You could also add this liquid attractant that I've got here. It's called the goo. It clouds up the water in the immediate vicinity of the hook bait, and you could squirt this either directly onto a PVA bag, onto a stringer, or directly onto the hook bait like I will now. Just squirt that on. Just a little dab of it, like that. And that will just cloud up the water in the immediate vicinity of your hook bait and attract the fish into the area. So there we have it, very basic setup that will catch carp from any venue.
Some things don't change in carp fishing, and two of the rigs that I use today for my big carp fishing are the same as I've used year on year. We've shown them to you guys before, and that's because they carry on working. It's as simple as that. The Benchmark Chod rig, you know, it's a little bit overused now. Be careful where you use it. If the fish have been hammered on it, then perhaps it's wise to try something else. But used well, used in the right situation, the Chod rig is still a seriously effective catcher of carp, and it's one that is very, very much in my armory still now. I'm going to take you through how I tie this. I've shown this before, but it's very, very critical how I make these to get the best out of the rig. So to start with, we're going to take some 25-pound mouth trap, and that is whipped using our whipping knot to a size 6 choddy hook. 5 or 6 turns is about right, and once that knot is bedded down onto the shank of the hook, it's passed through the back of the eye to exit through the front of the eye, and then you can line it up, make sure it's straight, tight and bedded down. Take the tag end, snip it off, and then onto that slide a mini rig ring. Our new mini rig rings, in fact all of our metalware, is now ultra black, dark, non-reflective metal items, so perfect for this kind of covert carp rig. So we're going to take the mini rig ring, slide it onto that tag end, and then pass that back through the hook eye before blobbing it with a lighter, and then I use the tip of my finger just to make a mushroom head while that material is melted. Let it set, take your finger away, and then use the tip of a chodit tool to form the D and pull the mushroom head back into the hook eye so that will never come undone. That's the connection to the hook and the D and the attachment of the bait, or where we're going to attach the bait. The rest of the hook is, or rest of the rig rather, is quite simple. We've got a very, very curved section of 25 pound mouth trap, which comes down to the loop section. Again, you can use a crimp system to make this, or do it the old fashioned way as I still do, which is just tie a loop. I tie this to a size 11 ring swivel, and the loop is the 2-turn twice tucked blood knot. Very simple. I form that around a puller tool, pull it down, and generally it will close up on a hard fighting fish, on other fish or small tench and so on. It doesn't close down at all. It means you need to tie a new rig after each fish, not a problem. But what that does do is give the rig amazing movement in 360 degrees. Now, I've proved this time and time again on big hits of carp. All the fish are hooked the same way, middle of the bottom of the lip, and that means that the fish must be coming into the area from all different random directions. The rig's spinning as it's supposed to, and it's hooking them in the same place every time. So that's proof in the pudding as far as I'm concerned. So the ring swivel is simply mounted onto either a leg call leader, if that's your choice, or onto a naked system using 20 pound subline or our contour fluorocarbon, which is also perfect where there's no heavy weed. A nice big solid curve, like so. I like to get the point of the hook so that it's parallel to the lake bed. I do sometimes PVA these up, a little bit of PVA tape just there, and then nick the hook point through for long cast will ensure that you maintain that perfect C. And that's the chod rig, that's how I use it. If I want a little bit of extra movement, if I'm trying something a bit different, the stiff hinge is still my benchmark big carp rig. This is the version of it I've been using for quite a few years now. So you'll notice that the actual hook section is exactly the same as the chod section, which I just showed you, but it's connected to a boom which is made from 30 pound end trap semi-stiff. Semi-stiff is perfectly rigid enough to throw the bait away. A slow sinking hook bait will be booming away from the lead like so. And all I do is tie a figure of 8 loop knot in either end of that boom just for movement. And really you want it to sit like so, so the ring will travel on the loop. Add the putty to the knot just behind where the pop-up section is, and at the other end, nice and simple, we've got a ring swivel leader on a loop, and that goes straight onto your leader. And that is my version of the stiff hinge rig. I caught a lot of big carp on this, and it's always in my armory. Well, there you go, 17.5 pounds of feisty little mirror. Tie the rigs that I've just showed you with precision and attention to detail, and fish like this can be yours. Cool tutorials have been running very successfully for over 2 years now, and a lot of anglers have gone away catching a lot more carp as a result. The man behind that, Daryl Peck. Daryl, I know I've got a cool tutorial booked up in the offing in the future, and until I get in there and see what goes on behind the scenes, I just wanted to get inside your head a little bit, because you've been working some magic and catching some of the punters some really good fish, haven't you?
Yeah, it's been really good. You know, I try not to set an agenda for the lesson other than get across a few key points. But one of the main things I want is them to catch, to believe in what I'm saying, so it shows that it works, you know. But we've had some really good fish. No 30s this year. Last year we had a few 30s, I think 3 or 4 30s.
Some of those were PBs, I guess, were they?
I'd say more than half of the customers have had personal bests on the lessons. Although that's not necessarily the aim.
Objective, is it? It's, yeah. It's about learning. But if they're catching fish of a lifetime at the same time, then
it's really great.
It's money well spent, isn't it?
One recently said to me, I mean, in the car park, I said, what do you want to do today? He said, if you can catch one over £10 today, I said, that would make my day. I was like, £10, I said, we can do that. We went on Brazenose one, been 15 minutes in an 18 pounder, and halfway through the day, did a 21, no, 22 pounder. So yeah, he had about 10 fish, a couple of 20s. It was a good day.
So if you're looking at a broad cross section of the people who have come on Core Tutorials with you, what would you say are maybe the key things that you're putting into their angling? What are they going to walk away with?
Well, I try and focus on the things that determine whether you catch your blank. You know, there's a lot of variables that you can adjust, but there are certain key things that can make or break your session, you know, determine whether you get that bite or not. And the name of the game really is to A, find the fish, B, put a bait where they can get at it, mm-hmm. C, where they want to get at it, something on the end they want to eat, a sharp hook, an end tackle system that doesn't tangle, and you're pretty
basic
much
basic good angling skills. But do you find that a lot of people who are coming on these quarter tours, perhaps, you know, they're not paying attention to that? They think that maybe there's a wonder bait or a wonder rig that's going to do it for them.
I'd say most of them are looking for that from me. You know, they come and they're thinking there's some sort of secret, and I try and show them those basic skills, like doing it right, the feeling the lead down, the locating the fish, the making sure your end tackle doesn't tangle. And then while we're doing that, I try and instill a little bit of like the hunter instinct, you know, like I try and notice things, and I'll talk out loud and try and bring that into their fishing. And sometimes I'll see something and I say, what do you think I'm thinking now I've seen that, and try and get them to answer the question themselves, you know. And if they get it right, then good, and if not, then I say the answer and then we move on to the next bit.
Fantastic, excellent. Well, I mean, it's definitely worth pointing out. I mean, I know you've been around to a lot of different venues with the guys, but whoever books you can take you to their own lake and learn how to master it to some extent with your guidance, can't they? Which is a huge edge.
Yeah, I would say that's the best way to do it. You know, I'd say most of the lessons tend to be at linear because it's like an easy access for a lot of people from up north and all around London. But in an ideal world, if you're booking a lesson to try and improve your skills and try and catch more fish from any venue, the best thing you can do is bring me there. I can have a little look at it, think out loud with you, say what I would do. We can fish the day and the things that I learned there that I can give to you and you can take on.
Mm. Going back to what you said earlier about, people think that maybe there's a magic rig or a magic bait. Do you think that generally they're quite surprised when they realise it's actually paying attention to detail of the small things, the basic things, when they actually see that happening? Are they usually quite shocked?
Yeah, I think so. I think they're thinking that there's going to be a magic wonder rig or a bait and stuff. But when they see it, it's not necessarily about that. It's about just doing things accurately, consistently.
Observation.
And observation. But understanding what you're trying to achieve. You know, some people quite often settle for that'll do. And that's something I never do. I'm never that'll do. You know, it's always got to be just so. You know, because if you're going to cast out and leave a rod in the rest for hours, you've got to know that it's doing what it should be doing for you. Mm. I.e. sitting on a spot where a carp can get it, not tangled with something they want on it. And hopefully there's fish swimming around it at the time, you know, and then it's up to them.
You'll find all the contact details for the Core Tutorials on our website, corda.co.uk. I've been lucky enough to fish with Daryl free of charge over the years because he's a mate, but believe you me, I've learned an awful lot from doing so, and you can too. So get yourself booked, catch more carp. Well, I'm just into the latter stages of a battle with another Winters Lake Manor Farm fishery carp, and it's feeling like a reasonable fish, this one. It's covered a fair bit of ground, and I'm hopefully going to get him in shortly. I'm just going to take this opportunity to tell you about the end tackle that I'm using. The area that I'm fishing is quite silty, it's quite smooth, not too much weed. So I've gone for a helicopter presentation, and I've tied up some leg call leaders. Not too long, about 3 foot long, and I'm using those in conjunction with the new incredibly safe no trace system. And this is absolutely a must if you're fishing any kind of rotary rig, so that's a chod on the line or any kind of helicopter rig. It really is the last word on safety, and in my opinion is one of the most significant products we at Corda have brought out in recent years. It's taken things massively forward, and it means that you can fish rigs like this with total confidence that if you do lose any tackle, the fish can always get rid of it. So to make the leader up, this fish is off again now, taking a lot of line. Fantastic. The 3.25 DF is absolutely compressed into this. It's a powerful one. So to make the leader up, to start with, I'm stripping the lead wire out from a length of cable lead core, taking out 6 or 7 inches of that, and then once I've done that, I'm going to thread on the sleeve part from the No Trace lead core kit. So the sleeve goes up the leader, fat end up the line, thin end down towards the lead. Slide that on about 4 or 5 inches, and then this guy's just plodding around out there. Next thing that goes on is a barrel bead, and the barrel bead is, if you're using chod rigs or anything like that, it just holds the hook point up away from the lead, meaning you're not going to blunt the hook or anything when you're casting. After the barrel bead, we're going to slide on a heli rubber, and lastly we're going to splice on a quick link, which just means that we can interchange the lead size as and when we see fit, when it's necessary. For this session and for most of my fishing, I use a nice light lead, the smallest I can get away with. I'm using an ounce, 1 ounce, ounce and a half maximum to reach these fish. So that's clipped on last. I cut the swivel off and just put the lead, the loop from the lead straight onto the quick link. And that completes the setup. The other end, again, I've stripped out the wire for about 6 or 7 inches, and I've spliced a loop into the end. And then you can simply drop your ring swivel down onto the leader. I mean, I'm dropping down the whole hook link, but if you're using a ready-made chod rig or anything like that, it can just slide down, because you can add them from this end with a no-trace system, because the bead is yet to be put on. And that's the last thing that goes on onto the sleeve. The tapered sleeve is the no-trace bead, which is the magic bead with the slot, the disappearing bead, and that ensures that the rig is completely safe in the event of a breakage. I think I've got a fish on the other rod. It's starting to get a bit busy. And that completes the setup. Really is the safest system. If I had my own lake, I would make it mandatory for any kind of helicopter rig, naked chod, anything like that. The no trace system is taking helicopter rigs to a new level. Well, the second rod just tucked into the reeds down here. It's my old backup special Dyra Infinity 3¼ blank, best blank in the world. And I've had this one custom built with a full length cork handle, which I use for some of my fishing on Raysbury. Lovely rod. So this fish has come on my favourite bottom bait presentation that I just showed you. Amazing, absolutely fantastic rig. Just started really using it a lot this year, and I'm going to be using it a lot more because it's working superbly. Come on, there we go. Well, how about that? The no trace system with a bottom bait rig and a hybrid boilie spread around with a stick has paid off in devastating style on the last day. Got a brace of fish in the net once. My other net down there has got a fish in, because I always carry two nets, so I had to put two fish in one net. No choice on this occasion. So how I deal with them now is very, very important. I'm obviously not going to lift them both out of the net at the same time. I'm going to try and get one out of here and into the sling, and then we'll take him up on the bank and have a look. Well, there you go. That's one half of what was in my landing net. Managed to get him on the bank perfectly safely. 26.5 pound. The common that I've got in there is about the same, maybe bigger. So two great, great fish made up. No trace helicopter systems, without a doubt the safest lead core presentation around. Well, there you go, the other half of the brace, two in the net at once, 23.5 pound of mint common carp. This one, like all the others, was perfectly nailed in the middle of the bottom lip. A size 6 mixer on the stiff bottom bait rig doing the job. It's been quite a day. I love my carp fishing.
I'm going to talk you through a few of the presentations that I've been using since the launch of the fake food. They all cover a different aspect of fishing that I might be doing, and the first one is when I'm covering boilie fishing. Now, when you're fishing over a big spread of boilies, it's sometimes nice just to make your boilie stand out from the crowd. If you pick one out exactly the same as everything else, obviously you will catch, but I believe it can take longer, or it's just a bit more pot luck that they get to pick yours up. So it's always nice to be able to tip it with a different colour. Now, we've got four colours in the range of the fake food in the corn. This is one of the super buoyant, and it's in the fruity squid flavour. Pink is a colour that I've been using a lot in my fishing for the last couple of years anyway, so as soon as this was out, it was something I was very, very keen to use and have done ever since. It means that your hook bait is that bit more buoyant than those boilies around it. So when the carp comes in to feed, there's every chance this is going to fly back that bit further in its mouth, meaning you've got a much bigger chance of hooking it quicker. That's the first one. My second option, I really only use this one when I'm fishing over a bed of particle. If you're fishing over sweet corn, hemp, bit of ground bait, maybe crumb boilie as well, I like to try and offer something that's similar to what they're feeding amongst. Now, I actually choose to pop this up over the bottom, which a lot of people don't, but again, I want my hook bait to stand out from everything else around it. So I always use two grains. It sits in the water like that, so it's sort of cocked and ready for action. So a carp just comes in and again flies a long way back in its throat and aids hooking. Now with the infused flavour as well, this is Ali's concoction of the IB flavour, so it's very fruity, and when you smell it, you can understand just why those carp are going to home in on your hook bait a bit quicker than they would have done otherwise. And thirdly, this is using the slow sinking corn. Now, this one is something that I use when I actually take my little boy fishing. We go to a few little runs waters with lots of small carp present, so I like to fine everything right down. You still see lots of people fishing with big boilies for carp that are no more than 5 to 8 pound, and you've got a much better chance of catching them quickly if you go down and just make the food items you're trying to feed them as small as it makes it easier for them to eat. So I use a single grain of corn down to a size 10 hook, and because it's critically balanced, it only just sinks. So the hook will lay flat on the deck, but your bait will just sit above it. Again, back to as with the other two rigs, you've got a more buoyant hook bait than everything else around it. And believe me, when this goes in, it stays in. With this one, it's very nice as well. As with all the other bits, you can experiment with colours. My personal preference is the pink and has been for a long time, but I've also caught a lot on these other colours already. With every single one of these presentations, I also incorporate a real stinky, fishy stick mix. I like my hook bait to be the smelliest thing out there, so I'll always utilise the long chuck system. It doesn't have to be a very big stick, just enough to give a nice pocket of attraction.
It's cold, it's wet, the bites have dried up for the meantime, so I've taken shelter beneath the Tempest, and I'm going to take a few moments to take you through our range of Legcore products. The key one we sell is the bulk spools of cable, also in a 7 metre spool to fit your tackle box. And those guys are for making your own Legcore leaders. Obviously, you can make them any style that you want, but if you want to take the headache out of preparing the leaders yourself, we do a whole range of ready tied leaders that are ready to go and will suit just about any kind of angling situation. All of those leaders are 1 metre long, and they come in both of our popular colours, gravel brown, which is suitable for gravel obviously, or sandy type spots, and also the weedy silk colour, which is suitable for dark colour bottoms and also fishing over weed. The two leaders that we sell at the moment are based around two particular styles of fishing. First of all, we have the ring swivel leader, and this is one of these guys. This is the 1 metre silk and weed variant. Now this is spliced to a size 8 ring swivel, and this is designed simply to be used in conjunction with an inline lead. So when that's threaded onto the leader and the swivel is pulled into the housing of the lead, that's ready to go. It really is that simple. You can add a tail rubber if you prefer. If you're using a stiff hook link, it's not necessary, and that pulls out nice and easily from the front of the nose to make sure it's safe. So that's how you would use the ring swivel Legcore leader. The next one, which is in a range at the moment, is the hybrid leg clip. Now this fella is ready spliced on here. As you can see, it's spliced to the loop at the back of the clip. This is my personal favourite clip in our range because it ensures that the lead is ejected very quickly in weedy situations. It's got a nice, soft, flexible arm, and as you can see, the lead comes off very quickly. I'm using this during this session in weed, and it's working for me very, very well. So I'm just going to pop this lead back on that arm. Always remember, when you assemble this, once you put the lead on, wet the stem and just nip the sleeve on like that. That's more than enough, and you're ready to go. Hook link onto the swivel. If you want to use this in conjunction with one of our ready tied rigs, obviously we do a range of ready tied carp rigs, including the KD rig, the DF rig, and some more basic type hair rigs. If you want to incorporate one of those, then simply cut away the ring with some snippers, and then you can attach it using a loop system or add a quick link change system and a silicone sleeve. So very, very variable. So fishing it like that, you can use it straight off the shelf. Just add a leader, a ready tied hook link and a boilie, and you're ready to go. They're the two in the range at the moment. We've got one new fella on the block. Now this is going to be out during 2013, and this is a helicopter version incorporating the no trace safety system. Now, as you can see, it will be sold like this. We've got a helicopter sleeve which covers a quick link. I've got a 2 ounce lead on there. I've cut the swivel off there, and that's on there attached like that. You've got a barrel bead which is designed to, when you're using chod rigs, to hold the rig away from the lead. I'm just going to push that down there. Size 11 ring swivel and your no trace safety system. Again, like all of the other leaders, that's 1 meter long. It will be in silt and weed and also gravel brown. And like all of the leaders, they will be spliced in the end, super strong. So all you need to do to attach that to your main line is to use a 5-turn grinner knot, or if you prefer, a Palomar knot. If you want to take the swivel off of this, simply take the bead off, slide the swivel off, and you can slide on any one of our ready tied chod rigs, which are perfect for use with this. So you would just simply slide the ready tied chod rig onto the end of the leader, down there against the bead, and then replace the bead like so. So very, very versatile. They're the three leaders in the range: the helicopter, the ring swivel for inline leads, and the hybrid leg clip. That really is a leg core leader to suit any situation you're faced with. Well, I'm attached to a small but very feisty common. I was baiting up over the top with a few boilies with the catapult when it went off. And if I can get this fella in, he's giving a good account of himself despite his small size. This was caught on the leg core leader with the no trace safety system. Well, this little scamp of a common has brightened up my morning. Beautiful little fish caught on a helicopter rig using leg core and the no trace safety system. Devised for any kind of helicopter rig, naked on the line or with leg core, the no trace system is taking rig safety to a whole new level.
Now we're going to talk about the quarter crimp tool. As you can see from the top end here, you've got two little letters, S and L, quite simply for small and large. There's two different sizes of crimp, so it's all kept nice and easy and straightforward for you to use. When you use it, you need to make sure that the crimp sits in here lengthways, and as you crush down its length, and you're just left with one smooth barrel. Very simple to use. You thread the crimp down one side into the swivel and back through into the other side of the crimp. Like I say, it's double barreled, so it's really, really simple to do. When you squeeze down, you just got to make sure you put constant pressure on. You can't over tighten it, which is where the quarter crimp tool works best. There's no way you can damage the hook link as long as you get it centrally in the holes, constant pressure all the way down. It's helped my fishing massively. I've been using chod rigs now for a good couple of seasons, but I like to use them really, really short, as you can see. And when it comes to tying that knot at the bottom, it can be really, really tricky, not with the crimp tool. I can now get them to the exact height that I need to, and the bonus of adding in a simple loop as well. So that's the quarter crimp tool. I just want to point out to you that you can't use it with the end trap soft or the semi-stiff. The coating is simply too soft and it will just pull straight through. We recommend that you use it in our mouth trap in either 15, 20 or 25 pound breaking strain. If you prefer a coated hook link, then it can be used on the hybrid stiff. That comes in weed green and gravel brown. It's fine on both of them. It certainly helped my fishing. I'm sure it can help yours too.
Right, I'm going to run through solid bags in some detail now. To start with the rig, it couldn't really get any more simpler. Basically, how I tie it up, get supernatural braid, and do prefer 18 pound. Start off, figure of eight loop, thread the pop upon. Now, with hook baits, it all really depends on the fishing situation. At the moment, we're going into autumn. I'm not fishing over boilies, I'm trying to get a quick bite, so I've opted for a pop up. So, threaded the pop up on. Then going down, you can see a rig ring. That works on a blowback purpose. So as the fish picks it up, goes to blow it out, that boilie will move there freely, pulling the hook point home. From then, I'm threaded on the hook. I've gone for a wide gape size 6, purely because to match with the pop-up, and plus we're fishing in weedy water with some big fish, so obviously you've got to match the hook size. Then you can see a little bit of shrink tube. That works to kick the hook around. So as the fish picks it up, it will turn it round and catch hold. And then threading on a small sinker. Now what I've done is put a little bit of dark matter putty on. Now I've not done it so it anchors right down. I've had little bits on and putting it in the margins and checking that it always sinks slowly. So what this will do, when the bag dissolves, that's going to sit there for them to see. Now, the leaders, I tie up quite a number of them for preparation. So, nice short boom. You don't need them too long. Obviously, for anti-tangle purposes, you don't really need it because your whole rig's within the bag. I've literally spliced that so you've got a loop. I work these on like a loop-to-loop. So, loop at the end of the line and can just thread it on. So, once you've had a fish, thread a fresh one on, straight back out. Same with recasting. It couldn't get any simpler. And now, because we're fishing a weedy water, I've opted for a drop-off system. So as you can see, the lead core is running around the inline lead, so it will drop off when you get a take, but not when you bring it in. Now, with this rig, the beauty of it is, you can get away with a really short hook link. Now, you wouldn't want a long hook link because you're putting it all into the bag. Now, how it works, obviously when they come in, you've got a small little pile of bait there, they'll suck it in, and as you can see, it's instant in contact with the lead. You've got no lead clip there, where you've got extra bit of movement straight away, all the weight is on that lead. Now, moving on to the solid bag and how I tie it up. So to start with, I open it up and put a small bit of bait on the bottom. Now what I'm using today is just a mixture of pellets and some ground bait with different oils in. What you want to do is always make sure you're using different size baits. You never want to use one size of pellet. What that would do is make the loads of gaps and air gaps and not make it tight and compact, which you always have to do. So, layering in the bait, always making sure that you layer in the rig with it. So hook bait in the corner, bit of bait in, layer it in, and then putting the lead in, you have to make sure it's always central. If that is at all going left or right, when you cast out, it will either go which way the leader is kicking out. So always make sure it's bang central. So making sure you're putting the bait around it and always making sure you pat it down and make it nice and compact. So as you're putting the bait in, pause for a second, and just give it, with these bags, you can give them a good old beating, obviously making sure they're not damp at all. So keep patting them down, making sure they're perfectly shaped. So keep going in, and then to the top, I don't lick and twist them, I like to tie them off. So twisting, making sure you get all the air out, making sure it's drum tight, because you think you can put these in excess of like over 100 yards. So if they're floppy at all, they're gonna catch the wind and fly off. You wanna make them like a little bullet, almost like a lead. So keep compacting it down, twist it off, now tie it off with some PVA tape and then cut all the excess down. And then finally, making sure you lick and stick it, so pulling the corners off and sticking it in to make it nice and aerodynamic. Now, the situations I would use it in, I pretty much have it in my armoury all the time because there's so many different times you can use them, especially here, there's a lot of little clear spots in the weed, perfect to drop in, nice and close in for margin fishing, but a lot of the time it's when I'm big hit fishing, so I'm going for a lot of fish, and like I said, having them already tied on the lead core leaders, just loop to loop them on, and you're not wasting any time at all, because it's always, when you have a fish, you're always rushing to get the rods back out, you've got wet hands, you know, you don't want to be rushing about, you want to go to the bucket, loop them on, and you're fishing within seconds. So there we have it, that's the solid bags. We do them in extra small, small, medium and large. For this instance, I'm using the extra small purely because I only want a small parcel of bait. I don't want them preoccupied on any food at all. So use the one that fits your situation and hopefully you'll get more fish on the bank for you.
How about that? A great way to end the session and to end this DVD. Over 27 pound of Manor Farm Common, proper bruiser, perfect way to end. Hope you guys have enjoyed watching. If we set out to inspire you even a little bit in your own angling and to educate you and help you catch more carp, then we've achieved our objective. That really is what we set out to do. And thanks very much to all our co-sponsors, all the other brands that have made this possible. And of course, to the venues that have hosted us. We've been to some fantastic lakes, from Lahore to Gigantica, and all the way to here, Manor Farm in Biggleswade, catching some lovely carp like this along the way. And lastly, I just want to thank all of the other guys, the co-hosts, and of course, the consultants and guests who have shared their valuable insights, all those little edges and tactics which you can put into your own fishing. and I'm sure we'll help you bank more fish. I've learned a lot, hope you have too. Look forward to seeing you again next year.